Hi, everybody. Welcome to Grace Honolulu Church Online. Wherever you're watching from, we are so glad you're with us today. You know, around here, we like to say everyone's welcome because nobody's perfect, but with God, anything is possible. We really believe that God has the power to change your life. And I invite you to open your heart today and experience the presence of God, perhaps like you've never felt it before. You know, as we begin to prepare the different phases of our reopening and regathering as a church community, we want to make sure that you stay informed. Be assured that our church is taking all of the necessary precautions to prepare a place where you will feel confident and safe to worship in. But if you haven't already done so, please text CONNECT to the number on your screen so that you will stay informed with all of the different things that we have going on in this next season of time. So right now, our worship team is going to lead us in worship. And I invite you to put away the distractions, quiet your heart, and invite the presence of God to fill your home and to fill your heart in a special way. Let's worship.
We'll be right back. praise break right here. Yeah, thank you, Lord. Come on, come on. Let's say, how
I am saved by grace. Love abounding, mercy found. I am saved by grace. I have life and it's only
Saturday. It
I am saved by grace.
Yes, Lord.
Turn it for good. You turn.
voice, declare it.
I'm going to see your victory. Yeah, for the battle belongs to you, Lord. I'm going to see your victory. I'm going to see your victory. For the battle belongs to you, Lord. I'm going to see your victory. I'm going to see your victory.
We thank you, God, for being our way maker, for being our promise keeper, and for shining your light in this darkness. And we thank you for sending us Jesus, who is the perfect example of how to do justice, how to love kindness, and how to live a life of humility and strength. Amen. Aloha, everyone. My name is Mariko Croswell, and I'm the Grace Kids Director here at Grace Honolulu. And I am so excited that I get to be here with you today. I want to send out a special hello to my Grace Kids families and to my team members. My family and I, we miss you all so much, and we look forward to the day when we will be able to meet together again in person. But until then, now more than ever, I want to encourage you to keep on showing God's love and His kindness to everyone that you meet. You know, I'm an introvert, and during this time, God has really shown me the importance of living together in community. So as my Grace Group ladies and I begin to discuss how we're going to meet together in person, with social distancing measures, of course, I'm reminded of a few important facts. That we grow stronger when we're together. That our relationships grow deeper when we're together. And that our collective lights shine brighter when we serve together. So if you're not yet a part of a Grace Group, I want to encourage you to text the word group to the number on your screen to find a group that best fits your needs. You know, during this time, I have had the amazing privilege to witness firsthand the faithfulness and generosity of this church. Through your choice to give your first fruits to God, so many people in our community have received God's hope and His joy. So thank you. Thank you for partnering with us to create a place where everyone is welcome, because nobody is perfect, and where with God, anything is possible. So I'd like to invite you to join me in giving today. The easiest way to give is to text GRACE808 to the number on your screen. We thank you to those who have already given online. Let's pray. Dear God, we thank you so much for your never-ending faithfulness and love towards us. We thank you for being our great provider, and we thank you for giving us this amazing opportunity to partner with you to spread your word across the globe, where hearts will be healed, where lives will be transformed, and where your people would unite, Lord God, with your hope and your truth and your joy and your peace at the center of their lives. We ask, Lord, that you would prepare our hearts right now to receive the powerful and life-changing message that you have for us today. Amen.
Aloha, everybody. Welcome. We're so glad that you're with us today. Around here, we like to say everyone's welcome, because nobody's perfect, but with God, anything is possible. That means today, if you are despairing, if you are feeling hopeless, or if you're even lonely, you need to know that with God, anything is absolutely possible with our God. Today, I want to take a pause moment to talk about something that is surfacing in our country. We have this moment where we're just able to see more clearly than ever the deep-seated pain and the deeply embedded injustice of our country. And it's coming to the heart of our country. And it's also coming up in many of our hearts as well. We feel the pain of it. I was thinking about this last week. I have five kids, and I also have a sister, and my parents are still alive. And let me ask you this question. If somebody in your family was experiencing pain, but it didn't directly impact your life, would you just go, well, you know what? I don't really need to take too much interest in that, because it's not really directly impacting my life. Or would you do everything you could to understand the pain and the injustice so that with empathy, you could pray with them, so that with empathy, you could support them, so that with empathy, you could stand up with them against the oppression, and so that with empathy, you could lead them to a place of healing and forgiveness and salvation in Jesus Christ? I think we'd all do the latter, because that's really what it means to be a part of a family. It's what it means to be part of our human family, but especially if you're a follower of Christ, it also really, that's what it means to be a part of God's family. In fact, Jesus prayed this prayer on the night that he was going to be crucified. He says this: my prayer is that all of them, those who were believers and those who were to be believers, they may be one. He says, I pray that they may be one. Father, just as you are in me and I am in you, may they also be in us, so that, and there's a reason for this, so that the world may believe that you have sent me, that I am the Son of God, that I am the Messiah. And there is a major blockage, a major hindrance that keeps us from being able to be the one that our Savior prayed for and that our Savior died and rose again for. And that thing is, it's racism. It is prejudice. It is this cultural bigotry that we see. It keeps that prayer that Jesus prayed from being answered. And as part of the body of Christ, the pain and the injustice that is being felt in the body of Christ and in our human body should bother us. In fact, I want to say, you know, to George Floyd, I'm sorry. And to George Floyd's family and to the Black community, I'm sorry. I'm sorry that it took something that was so inhumane and unjust, somebody kneeling on the neck of a man until he died, to shock us out of our apathy so that we begin to pause long enough and to be quiet long enough to ask some questions. Like, how did something like this happen? How did somebody do this to somebody else? Or I think maybe even more to the point, why did something like this happen? Or maybe even more specifically, and for today, why does something like this happen again and again and again in our country? Why? And as your pastor, I don't think the appropriate response is, it doesn't affect my life. I think as part of the family of Christ, our appropriate response is to hear what is going on so that we can identify with it and so that we can pray, so that we can support, so that we can stand up with, and so that we can lead people to our Savior. I think that's the appropriate response. So for us, I'm not okay as Grace Honolulu, and I want to invite you to not be okay with just being ignorant or to being silent or to being defensive or to being indifferent about what has happened. But I want to invite us to lean in and to open up our hearts. And I believe that God has something for us as we seek Him, as we humble ourselves, and as we even search our own hearts. I believe in that long run, we can be better lovers of God, lovers of people, and we can do what the Scripture tells us over and over again. We can act justly in the earth. That's how we represent our God. In fact, this is what the Scripture says in Micah 6, verse 8. And when they're wondering what they do with their guilt and they're bringing sacrifices and offerings, God tells them, He has shown you, O mortal, what is good. This is what's good. This is what I want you to do. And what does the Lord require of you? To do this, to act justly, to love mercy, and to walk humbly with your God. If, as a follower of Christ, you ever get confused and are wondering what you're supposed to do, this is what God says we're supposed to do. We're supposed to act justly, we're supposed to love mercy, and we're supposed to walk humbly with our God. And at the root of what we're experiencing right now, what has sparked this national outcry is injustice. That's what it is. And God says we are to act justly. So as followers of Christ, we should be troubled. We should be angry. We should be bothered by injustice. And we're also supposed to love mercy. And there are lots of opportunities for us to show mercy and compassion rather than indifference and judgment in this season. And then finally, we're supposed to walk humbly. In any conversation where you're trying to understand the perspective of somebody whose perspective and experiences are different than yours, walking humbly is essential. And so I want to invite you to act justly, to love mercy, and now to walk humbly as we engage in this conversation. In Romans 12, Paul says this to the Romans. He says, "Bless those who persecute you. Bless and do not curse." And Jesus showed us how to do that. And then he says, "Rejoice with those who rejoice and weep with those who weep." In order for us to express compassion, in order for us to express love and empathy, we have to weep with those who weep. Now, the difficulty of this is when the weeping doesn't necessarily connect with us. And at times this happens. I think this is part of the issue. Sometimes somebody's pain or sorrow doesn't connect with a person, so weeping is hard. But Paul doesn't qualify that. He says, this is what it means to follow Christ. We're supposed to weep with those who weep. And then he goes on and says, "Be of the same mind towards one another. Do not set your mind on high things, but associate with the humble." And then he says this, "Do not be wise in your own opinion," which is really hard. It's hard for all of us because I have an opinion and I have experiences and I have thoughts that have led to the formation of that opinion. But Paul says this, we need to not be wise in our own opinion, because when we are, we're not able to understand the perspective and the experiences of somebody else. Paul is saying, and I'm saying, be open. I want you to be open. So I want to invite you to join with me in taking a posture of humility so that we can learn together, so that we can even maybe recognize some of our own biases, and ultimately so that we can empathize better and be able to love our God better, be able to love the people that are part of our human family together, and so that we can be one as Jesus prayed, and not only be one, but so that we can act justly. And I want to introduce my friends as we have a conversation with Lamont and Patty.
Hi, Lamont and Patty.
Hey, guys.
Hey, Grace Honolulu family.
We are so excited to get the chance to talk to you guys.
Yeah. I think I recognize you from your involvement in our parent huddle and in our marriage huddle, but I'm going to talk a little bit about you just to brag on you.
Okay.
This is one of the initial families from our Grace Covenant Church in Chantilly, Virginia, which is one of our Every Nation churches. But they're also secret members of our church as well. Yeah. So for 1 year in person and like 11 months, but be honest.
1 month in person.
How many?
1 month in person.
1 month, what did I say?
1 year.
Okay, one month in person, yeah. And 11 months, that's what I meant. But how long did it take before you outed yourself in our services? You guys, how many years?
It took a while.
It took a while.
We just sort of hid in the back.
And I respect you and love you so much for that. I do. But over the course of the years, and really, I just want to thank you. Really, you guys pursued a relationship with us, and we really, really appreciate that. And you've become, over the years, really dear friends of ours. In fact, there's a select group of people that we invite to, just have a deeper friendship and be able to speak into our lives, like the scripture says, speak truth and love to one another. And you guys have been that for us. Even though Lamont is Pookie to you, he is one of the wisest and most manly men's men that I know. And I appreciate that. I could immediately connect with your character. And you are, Patty, you are one of the funnest and most powerful prayer women that we know. We've been so encouraged in our relationship. So we're really glad to be able to have this conversation with you. We love you guys. We have incredible respect for you.
It's our honor.
Thank you. And I know, I always feel that. But why is this such a difficult conversation to have?
I believe it's for a lot of reasons. We have to take that moment to examine where we are in our race awareness. And I think within that, everyone is at a different place. Mm-hmm. And that really goes back to maybe how you were raised or the environment or your own experiences. And I want to say that a lot of times it's painful because you either have your own pain or maybe you're witnessing someone else's pain. And we don't always know how to react to that. So I think that may be one of the reasons why it's so hard to have these conversations.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. You know, and also we're all kind of stuck in this culture that we got raised up in, right? And it's confusing, right? Because we've all sort of learned the same thing that culture is who we are, and it's our culture against their culture, and that's no matter where you go, right? No matter where you go,
yeah.
But then we also see the kind of bad things that creates, right, in real life, and we're like, well, it's very difficult to kind of reconcile in your mind and to have a conversation around it. Means, well, do I have to really examine myself and my family and how I think or behave or feel? And it's just very challenging. It's nobody's fault. It's just the way it is.
Yeah, no, I appreciate that. And you know what I really appreciated about that? Because I called you a couple days ago. You guys were on your way home from different peaceful protests, which I really love. And you were so gracious to us. I think that one of the things that's kind of scary about the conversation is for us and for many people at this level, it's a new conversation. And honestly, right. I don't exactly know at times what I'm feeling or what to say. And so if I feel like there's not the freedom to go ahead and have this imperfect conversation, then it's kind of scary to enter into and talk with you guys. I felt like you just gave us the permission to go ahead and have this imperfect conversation that we're having, which really, really helps. I think all of us, we just need that graciousness with each other to be able to talk at this level, to be honest at this level. So thank you. Thank you for making that environment possible for us. Yeah. So Lamont, maybe you could just start by just sharing a little bit of your story and your journey so that we can kind of understand who you are.
Thank you so much. I originally shared this story with the pastors at our church here at Grace Covenant. But at the bottom line for me is that, and I'm in my 60s now, but, you know, having grown up during the civil rights movement and lived in Atlanta and Pittsburgh and in Hawaii, I lived in Makiki for 10 years and a couple of other LA for a while. You know, I had plenty of time to have plenty of experiences of pain. From my college director telling me that, you know, as a black kid, I didn't belong there, from being at Roosevelt High School when I was there and being half black and wanting to date, you know, an Asian girl and her family kind of throwing a fit because, well, you know, he's Popolo and this sort of thing. And all these experiences developed a bitterness in me. Mm-hmm. And over from the time I was five, when I was a kid, you know, grew up in Pittsburgh and a handful of us went from the projects and we straight into a Holly neighborhood and we got jumped and there were six of us, if I recall, and 10 of them. And we were no slouches. I mean, we were from the hood. We could carry on water, but 10 against six is a bad day. I don't care, you know, where you're from. But, it, you know, those experiences marked me time after time again, and they started, and my response was I developed this bitterness in me, and it just grew. It grew year after year and decade after decade. And, you know, when my son left here, we live in Virginia, obviously, but when my son left here to go to college, a few years back, he was going to Connecticut for college. And I had to sit him down and I had to say his name is Sinclair. I had to say, hey, look, Sinclair, you know, because we live in a country here and he was going to a city. I said, well, you're going to be in the city and you need to understand how to survive an encounter with the police. I said, because you're a young black guy, they're not going to know you're a shining college student. They're just going to think you're just another kid. So I told him, I said, if you run into a cop on the street, if you get stopped, I said, the very first thing you want to do, Sinclair, is tell him, I'm a student at Yale. And hopefully that will change the temperature. And right. And I said, and the second thing you want to do is you want to keep your hands where they can see them. Okay. And it's painful to have to know I have to do that, but I know that had I not, I could get a call coming to identify his body one day. And that's just the reality, I think, of being black here on the mainland. But the story is to say that the Lord redeemed all that for me. He took those decades after decades after decades of experiences that built bitterness and callous in my heart. And he spoke to me and he said, you know, that bitterness is going to keep you from allowing me to use you to serve our people. That bitterness is unforgiveness. And I said, but Lord, you mean I really have to be forgiving? He says, you know, after all that, these are all things done to me. And he said, yes. I said, well, why? And he said, because 7 times 70. And you know the scripture about forgiving, right? 7 times 70. And so I fell on my face and I fell on my knees and I spent, this is over a period of 5 years, repenting, learning to repent of the bitterness that I felt I had a right to hold on to.
Mm. So good,
and God finally got me to a place where I was able to fully repent about a year and change ago. And it freed me up to love even my Caucasian brothers and sisters the way that the Lord loves them, to be able to serve God fully. And I'm so excited for it. And that's the story I believe you wanted me to share. Thank you, Grace.
That's great. No, that's great. Now, I remember when I asked you even that a couple nights ago when we were talking about this, what brought you to that moment of really searching your heart and wanting to be able to repent? You said, because if you harbor bitterness in your heart, this is what you told me, you wouldn't be able to share the gospel. You wouldn't be able to share Christ appropriately with your Caucasian brothers. And I love that. I love that, that you didn't want anything to be able to stand between you and your ability to share the love that you received. That's just so powerful. One of the questions that I'm asking myself, and I'm going to ask you to help me, Patty, with this, is, you know, what should our response be? I mean, how do we respond to what is beginning to stir in a lot of people's hearts? I'm wondering, what is the appropriate response or an appropriate response?
Well, you know, as I think about that, I have been so humbled by a lot of my white girlfriends, to tell you the truth, because they have called me or messaged me or texted me, and they've said things like, I didn't know, or I've been living in a bubble. You know, I won't stay silent. I stand with you. So that has been one of the most heartwarming things that I've experienced out of such pain, because for me, it's very painful. But I do feel like you, Pastor Greg, so now what do we do? How do we move forward? And I think in moving forward, we really have to ask ourselves four questions. What is my role in this? And what is my role as a Christian first? And as a Christian, I believe the first thing we have to do is examine our heart. We're all at different places, but I think it's okay to be angry or mad or not understand. These are a lot of the feelings that all of us are having.
Right.
But what is not okay is to be silent in this, because I believe, you know, throughout the Bible, we have scripture after scripture where we have the example how Jesus was moved with compassion. You know, we can talk about Matthew 9:36, where he said he had compassion on them because they were harassed and helpless like sheep without a shepherd.
Yeah.
I mean, there's example after example. Luke, he felt great compassion as she wept. And, you know, there's been a lot of weeping. There is a lot of even what I would say is confusion. And I don't think we have to understand it all. But I do think that one of the things we have to, as Christians, we have to, after we've examined our heart, we have to repent. And in that repentance, I think God's going to start revealing our part in this. You know, what are we supposed to do? How are we supposed to move forward? And then what is our role in the church? And I think we have to be a vessel. Understand God has called us to be vessels of reconciliation, 2 Corinthians. And in that, I really believe in being that vessel, God's going to give us opportunities. You know, as people are calling me, some of my friends are broken. Some of my friends are at the extreme. They're like, you need to get this. You know, some of my white girlfriends, you need to get this book to her white girlfriends and read it because you got white privilege. And that, I'm like, wait a minute, come back. Come back. You know, everyone, as I said, everyone's at a different place. You know, but we do have to act. You know, what are we supposed to do as Christians in the church? You know, we're supposed to be praying for our pastors to have wisdom. We're supposed to be praying so that we know, Lord, where are we supposed to move in this? You know, we're people that are supposed to be praying for people in authority. And God's going to give us different opportunities to move in reconciliation. And some of the reconciling, like Lamont said, is going to be in our own heart. And then in society, this is the last one, I believe, in our neighbors, of the four things we need to really check. If you see something, say something. You know, we can't be quiet anymore. And this doesn't just have to do, I believe, with race. We were in a Starbucks, and there was a gentleman mistreating the young lady behind the counter. So it wasn't necessarily race related. It's just that he took a stance of, I am better than you are. Mm. I'm more superior than you are. You know, that type of, that's a bigotry in itself. And so we're called, I believe, as Christians, to say something. Proverbs 4, the beginning of wisdom is this, get wisdom. So listen to your friends, ask the questions, even tell them, this is kind of awkward for me. Is it okay if I ask you some questions? You know, just be honest. Tell them, you know, I'm not sure I understand it all, but I'm praying about the situation. And in society, we need to get involved, okay? There's different levels of involvement, but as Christians, even in our local and state government, we are supposed to be involved. We can change the temperature of some of those things. So I think that's, you know, briefly, if that was brief enough, a kind of a broad swipe of some of the things we have to do, but we cannot be silent.
Oh, that's great. That's great. And I love that learning posture, you know, you're opening a wide door of just like there is a wide gamut of emotions. Nobody gets this thing perfectly, especially those who are trying to learn. But there's an invitation to learn, to, because otherwise we'll never be able to really empathize and show each other mercy if we don't at least try and step into the other person's experience. Which right. I think, you know, our go-to is to protect ourselves. We defend, no, I get it. And the reality is, yeah. You know, we probably don't, and we could learn a lot from each other. And then there's not that, you know, mysticism and wall of separation that keeps us from being able to show empathy and compassion towards one another.
Yes. Mm. Amen.
So Lamont, this is like your hometown. I mean, you are I was going to say Radford, but you're actually a Roosevelt grad. Go Rough Riders.
Rough Rider now.
And you come back to your hometown quite often. And so
yes.
help us, because I think sometimes being a local person, we can look at what's going on the mainland and go, well, that's there, but we don't really have that here. And we miss the opportunity to examine our own hearts and to see what might be there.
I have to say first and foremost that moving to Hawaii from Pittsburgh back when I was a kid and started at Stevens Intermediate, it was amazing. Because for the first time in my life, I didn't feel like a minority. It was just unbelievable to me. You know, that I could be in a place where I didn't feel like I was the minority anymore. And Hawaii is my first choice for home. It is. It's when I'm in Hawaii, I feel like, and I've told my wife last time we were, a couple times we were there, I said, you know what? I am made for this place. You know? And that's really how it feels. You know, I get mixed reactions from my ohana when I'm there, when it comes up, or I mentioned that I'm half black. I'm half black and half Japanese, for those of you who may not know. I get mixed reactions. Some people, it doesn't mean anything. Others, they like, oh, really? Because, I mean, it's rare. How many black Japanese guys are walking around, right?
You're special, baby. You're so special.
I get mixed reactions. The only time I've really seen it as a quote-unquote concern is, like I mentioned earlier, you know, when I was in high school and in the dating scene, right? Because I think that other parents, they couldn't get past the fact that I was a black kid, even though I'm just as much a Japanese kid. But I don't think that's any their fault either. I think that even in Hawaii, we're not immune from the images that TV and movies and the news project. Stereotypes, not just about black Americans, but about lots of people.
Yeah.
And I think it's normal that those things kind of seep into our mindset, right? Because, you know, you hear it enough times, TV show after TV show, and you kind of just kind of can become part of your thinking. But overall, I think the people in Hawaii have done a great job of not being prejudiced. Certainly nothing like it is up here on the mainland. Not even, it's two different worlds.
So you're real familiar with our culture here too. So you know that just prejudice and biases and just not being able to connect with another culture, it's not just a black and white thing, but it's a local thing as well. There are a lot of different cultures here as well. What would you say just to speak into our local culture and help us navigate? I'm going off script. I can tell you're trying to go, where's he going?
You got this.
Help us navigate just our own hearts in a culture where these things are just real part of all of our lives at some degree, some level.
Well, you know, as amazing as Hawaii is, and my love for Hawaii and my time there, and really I'd love to be there full time.
We'd love to have you here full time, by the way.
Open invitation all the time.
Yeah.
There's still a truth that there is some there's disparity in Hawaii. Starting with the Hawaiian people, I had a lot of friends from Papakalea when I was in high school, you know, which is the Hawaiian land up in that area. So, you know, and then there are other parts of Hawaii where you have Hawaiian lands, but there's still there's economic disparity to start, and there may be some others as well, right? And then there's some things that can go on between different cultures in Hawaii, the Polynesians, Filipinos, you know, Fijians, Japanese, Chinese, Koreans, Vietnamese, Haoles, things go on. Hawaii is a million times better than anywhere else. Don't get me wrong. But there are still disparities and there's separation. And if you ask me, Greg and Chris, I think it's sin.
Amen.
I think it's sin trying to do its job to keep people apart.
Amen.
I think it's a lie and it's a trick and it's something that has been used by sin to separate us.
Amen.
And so as believers, I believe that we have the best opportunity to reject that kind of thinking. That we have a reason, which is Christ, not to just casually adopt what got passed down through generations to us or from the culture in the islands around us, right? Just how people, that's just the way people think. We have the ability to question those kinds of thinkings and to put a stop to them in our own hearts. And then to rally around what God always intended, which is that God doesn't care where you come from. He doesn't care what your economic status is, what your ethnic group is, because guess what, y'all? In heaven, no neighborhoods.
Amen.
There's no rich diamond head crowd. There's no Eva crowd. There's no Manoa crowd. There's no Ina Haina crowd. It doesn't exist. Right?
Good, that's right. Fine.
Those are all barriers that sin has created amongst us, really as a weapon against the kind of love that God is hoping for us.
Amen.
And we as the church have the best opportunity to reject those barriers. And I think we in Hawaii have the best opportunity because we don't have nearly as much baggage holding us down. We in Hawaii have the best opportunity to be an example of what that really looks like. Yes.
So let's talk a little bit about cultures, because I think sometimes what happens as reaction to this is we want to just kind of blur it all together and just say, well, you know what, I'm really, I don't see color. And can you just, is that a good way to approach that? Should we do that? Should we?
I think the whole, and I'll let my beautiful wife jump in. I don't want to hog the the mic, but if you would, I think that
that was a snooky moment.
I think that this notion of colorblindness is a lie. It's another lie that's been woven to try to deny our cultural differences, right? And try to pretend that we could live on some sort of, we're all this sort of blob, this amorphous blob of all being the same when we know we're not.
Yeah.
And I think culture is really important. If I'm Filipino or if I'm Japanese, if I'm Haole, if I'm, you know, my folks are from England or France or China or, you know, Micronesia or Philippines, I mean, wherever, that matters. Culture is who we are. And it's important to love one another right where we are in our culture. We don't have to feel awkward about it and try to kind of like, right, tiptoe around it. Let's embrace each other's culture. Let's allow for we eat different foods and we do this dance differently and whatever it is that we dress differently. Let's allow for that. It's fine.
Right.
Yeah. I don't like colorblindness. I think it's a mistake. And I think it takes away from, you know, beauty of being different people.
So let me ask you this question. Why should all of this matter to us, especially as Christians? What is the, you know, why does it matter to us as followers of Christ, as a church? Why should it matter?
We're so grateful to be part of the Every Nation family. Yeah. And we join the Every Nation family because we believe that every nation is represented in the kingdom and we are one, you know, and matter, you know, I think as Christians, we're trying to learn the totality of God's word and that, first of all, we're not supposed to even see each other in the flesh, you know, and we've got to grow and cry out to God to see each other in the spirit and see each other. Christ sees us. He doesn't see this flesh. He sees our spirit. And then that, you know, as we're crying out for that, we can challenge ourselves. You know, one of the things I said, examine ourselves, examine our hearts, that we say, you know, when that person of a different color or ethnos comes in and you're saying something in your head, you need to bring that thought captive right then and nail that to the cross. Lord, I repent for thinking this way about my sister or my brother. That's what you were going to say, honey. Pookie.
I love it.
You guys have kids that are in their 20s and are in that category. We do as well. What would you say to that next generation? What would you say to them?
I would say to all of you young folks, this is your time.
Amen.
This is your moment. And I believe as an older person that you guys can actually lead us forward.
Amen.
You got to understand when you, by the time, you know, we age to this age, you know, we got a lot of baggage. I mean, it's not just one carry on anymore. Okay.
Speak for yourself.
We got a lot of baggage. Okay. And I believe that you young people, right. You don't have the baggage that we have. Right.
Amen.
And you can lead us into being better and we can follow you and we can learn. So don't shrink back. You know, I invite you guys, give us a chance to learn from you. Give us a chance to let you lead us.
So good. So that leads to this question then. So what do we do in response? You know, what practical steps can you give your church as we just want to be representatives of our God and of Christ more clearly, and we want to really be able to effectively love him and love other people? What can we do? What steps can we take?
I think the first thing I would say is we need to not be too hard on ourselves.
Amen. That's good.
Because it's a journey, and it's a hard journey, right? So we're going to need to give ourselves, each of us, grace. The second thing is I'd say that we need to be prayerful that God would open us up to be able to learn new ways. So we could lay down some of the things we picked up along the way about how we think about culture, race, what have you. and invite God to help us change. And then lastly, I'd say we need to love one another within the Grace Honolulu family.
Amen.
We need to love one another, love one another through this as we're all on this journey together. It's messy, right? So here we are as a family, a church family, and we're trying to move forward, right? And so we're having conversations, but guess what? In an atmosphere like this, on a subject like this, it's impossible not to say something where someone's not going to say, well, you didn't say enough, or you said too little, or you said it the wrong way, or you said it this way. So just expect that, right? And with the grace for one another, take the position right up front as we're going to love one another, and then we're going to love one another again as we journey through this together.
Amen. That's good. And that's what we will do.
Amen.
And when I say we, I mean we.
We.
That's right. Yes. As we're just finishing this time, would you please pray for your church? Pray for us.
Would you pray, honey?
I'd be honored to pray.
Thank you.
Father, we love you. Mm-hmm. We adore you. We worship you, Lord. We say that you are God and there is none like you.
That's right.
Father, we thank you that in this appointed time in history, you are allowing us to have an ear to hear what the Spirit of the Lord is saying.
Yes.
And Lord, we ask you to reconcile us, in the body so that we can be that light, that salt, that word of truth and love to the lost, to the hurting, Father God. Lord, we need your wisdom like never before. We need to be clothed with the mind of Christ so that we can fully love one another how you love us, Father. Mm-hmm. Lord, we're asking you in the holy name of Jesus Christ,
yes,
that you would bring us on one accord and like-minded in agreement in all things according to your word, that there's not room for opinion and different cultures. Lord, because you said there's one body and one hope. So Lord, we have our hope and our faith in you. And we as your children are crying out to you, Lord. Make us one as the Father and the Son are one, Lord. Bring your peace and restoration, Lord. Help us to repent where we need to repent, Father God. And Lord, help us to give grace, Father God, and be about your work, which you have called us to, which is the gift of reconciliation, Lord. In Jesus' holy name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
Man, I love that family and so appreciate their friendship and their help with our church community in navigating through this conversation. Like Lamont said, and I love this, he said, there are no neighborhoods in heaven. That's why we're part of a ministry called Every Nation. We believe that God's kingdom doesn't look like just me, and it doesn't look just like you. It looks like all of us, every nation, every tribe, every tongue and people group under the heavens. That's what God's kingdom will look like in the very end of days. And I'm so excited that we've had this conversation. And Pastor John Gray said something like this, and I'm paraphrasing. He said, when there's empathy, we won't see this lack of humanity. So Grace Honolulu, what should we do? This is what I'm inviting us to do, four things. Number one, I'm inviting us to examine our hearts. Let's examine our own hearts. Let's ask God to lead us through our hearts and show us the anger or the prejudices or the biases that we each might have in our own hearts. Here's the second thing I'm asking us to do. Let's invite the presence of the Lord to be our guide in this. We can't do it alone. And if we try and do it alone, and if we try and change our hearts or change somebody else's heart without the presence of the Lord, all of our compassion and activism and all the things that we do, therefore not. But if we invite God in, then God can work powerfully in our lives and in our world. And then the third one, this is really important. I think if our world did it, if the United States did it, we would all be stronger for it. But admittedly, this is awkward. It's difficult. It's going to be a challenge. But here's what I'm asking us to do. I'm asking us to begin the necessary dialogue or conversation that we need to have with one another, to understand each other, to have a conversation with somebody who is not like you, maybe whose skin color is different than yours or whose ethnic background is different than yours, so that you can understand. It's the only way that you and I can gain an empathy so that we can appropriately love the people in our lives and around us. And so maybe it's a friend or a coworker, or maybe it's somebody that you go to church with, or somebody in your small group. You go to small group with them, but maybe you don't have yet a relationship with them. Build a relationship, a friendship, and have a conversation with them, an honest conversation. Is it going to change the world? No. But it may change you, and it may change your perspective, and it may change your world. In fact, if we all did that, it would collectively change the world that we live in. And then fourth and last, I would suggest this. We just need to, in the real world, in real time, when we see injustice on a local level, regional level, global level, we need to do something about it. We need to speak up. We need to not just be good with injustice, but we need to, as we read in the scripture, act justly, love mercy, and walk humbly with God and with each other. Church, I want to invite you to pray with me as we just bring our hearts before God. God, we need you. We need you in this moment, Lord. We can't do this on our own. And so we rely on our Savior, who lived a perfect life, who died on a cross in our place, and who died for our sins, and then who rose again from the dead, demonstrating that you had power over death, hell, and the grave. We need you. We need your presence and your power to guide us through this. Lord, to guide us through our own hearts. Lord, I pray that you would help us to have the courage to engage with somebody else in this conversation so that we can understand and we can gain an empathy that we need to be able to love people in our lives with a more Christ-like type of love. So we ask for that. Lord, may we, when we see justice, not be okay with it. Lord, may our hearts be changed as we engage in this way with one another. Help us be the kind of people that act justly, that love mercy, and that walk humbly with our God. I just want to take a couple seconds just for us to be able to search our hearts and to let things come to the surface. It can be uncomfortable. Maybe for some of us, it's just deep-seated anger and bitterness because you have been unjustly treated. Maybe for others of us, it is a guilt or it is a prejudice of our own, the way that we look at somebody or maybe dismiss somebody or have seen injustice. And because it's not directly affected us, we've kind of just ignored it and walked on. Whatever it might be, would you just let that come up to your heart and then bring it to the only place where it can ever be dealt with, the cross of Jesus Christ. Father, we thank you that we have a Savior who died on a cross to pay the price for our sins. And Lord, we bring our anger, we bring our bitterness. Lord, we bring the sin of indifference and the sin of tolerating injustice. Lord, we bring that to the cross as well. We bring our prejudices and our biases. Lord, everybody has sinned and fallen short of the glory of God, but you gave us a Savior. So we turn to him today and we ask him to forgive us, to cleanse our hearts, to heal our wounds, and to fulfill the prayer that Jesus prayed. Lord, make us one people that love you, one people that represent you, one people that act justly, love mercy, and that walk humbly with our God and with each other. We thank you for it. In Jesus' powerful name. Amen. Amen. Your God is good. With him, anything is possible.
Against us. Come on, every voice. Come on, you take.
You take what the enemy meant for evil, and you turn it for good. You turn it for good. You take what the enemy meant for evil, and you turn it for good. You turn it.
Come on, let's declare. Say it again.
You take what the enemy meant for evil, and you turn it for good.
Our battles belong to God. Your battles, no matter what they are, they belong to God. He is with you. He is for you. He is working in your life, and He is working through your life. So I'm going to encourage you to trust Him with all of your battles. And you know what? This is a really great time to continue the conversation that we started today, or to begin a conversation with somebody. And we have groups, we call them small groups, grace groups, that meet in different locations on different days and times throughout the week. And we want to invite you to be a part. And you can find out more information about our grace groups, our small groups, by texting the word group to the number on the screen. Have a great week. We'll see you next week as we gather again to begin a brand new series called The Comeback. God bless.